All right, y'all, pull up a chair. We're about to go over 10 mistakes that I see rookie investors make all the time. Hey, y'all, welcome to the show. As I said, we're going over 10 mistakes that I see rookie investors make all the time. Like, to be honest with you, part of the reason I love real estate and I've made so much money in real estate is and the opportunity to make so much in real estate is there is because real estate is like a super imperfect business with a fairly like low barrier to entry, right? It's kind of like the restaurant industry, right? Like people talk about becoming an entrepreneur. Everybody's like, oh, I can start a bar. I can start a restaurant, right? Anybody that like sits in the bar and likes drinking beer is like, oh, I should make a bar, right? And then you get all these people, you know, pretty low barrier to entry, right? And they start these bars and restaurants and a bunch of them fail, right? It's very similar in real estate, right? Like anybody could buy like a rental property or anybody could try to flip a property, but actually being good at it, right? That's how you make money. And the people that are really, really good at investing in real estate, you know, we are benefited by the fact that so many people try to get into the business and they fail, that it provides us with like, you know, good opportunities, right? Like, think about it, right? Like you buy a flip where somebody went in and they tried to do the flip and they screwed the whole thing up and they're out of money, right? You could get that flip at a discount if you're good. Or like buying rental properties from tired landlords, failed landlords, things of that nature, right? So lots of opportunities because of all the mistakes, right? So be smart, guys. Don't make those mistakes. So I got 10 mistakes that I put together. These are things that I see all the time, having done over $200 million worth of investment transactions, you know, working with investors from all over the world. These are like 10 of the most like common mistakes I see people make. Not necessarily in any particular order, although I will say definitely stick around because number 9 and number 10 are probably two of my favorite ones to talk about. And I think it's like something that I just see you guys do all the time that like we really need to hammer down. But let's get into it, right? And the first one I will say is not taking action fast enough, right? This is that analysis paralysis. Right, sitting on the sidelines, right? Maybe you're on Facebook or like Bigger Pockets or YouTube or TikTok and your Instagram. You're watching videos, reading forums, thinking about investing, and then you're like, you never pull the trigger, right? Sometimes you just gotta freaking pull the band-aid off and pull the damn trigger, guys. This is real estate investing. By and large, the best time to buy a property was probably yesterday, okay? When I started investing, right, we were picking up like freaking duplexes that rented for like $1,200 a month for like $30,000, right? Almost 15 years later, those same duplexes, man, those things are renting for freaking, oh, I don't know, almost $1,800 a month, and they're worth like $160,000, right? Things like that. So you don't want to miss out, right? When I started investing, interest rates were like friggin' 3%. Now they're above 6, right? You know, if you buy and the interest rates are high, you know, you can always refinance, right? But like generally speaking, prices and stuff are typically always going to go up. Yes, some markets have higher appreciation and some have like lower appreciation. But in general, right, this is a freaking hedge against inflation. The values are always going to go up, right? So you got to take the action, man, because odds are good. If you're thinking about doing an investment and then you wait like 4 or 5 years, you're probably going to be in like a worse position. It was probably better. The properties you could have got, the deals you could have got 5 years ago, you probably can't get them anymore, right? So that's number one. And then number two is the complete opposite, and that's taking action too fast, right? Just explained, you know, the negatives to being too friggin' slow, but you don't want to be too fast. You still have to do a little bit of research, right? Figure out what kind of investing you want to do. Figure out the types of properties. Figure out a market that makes sense. Make sure you have a team in that market that you know, that you trust. Make sure you know what you're getting yourself into. Make sure you've lined up your financing. Don't just jump in and do these deals too quickly. Don't close until you've done the due diligence, right? Inspection, appraisal, things of that nature, right? You can't jump in without knowing anything, right? You need to do a little bit of research, but don't get yourself caught up in the analysis paralysis, okay? Next, number three, spending too much money on the rehab, okay? You don't want to do that. And truth be told, this is less common than number four, which is spending too little on the rehab, right? So we'll talk about these together. Spending too much, spending too little. There are a lot more people out there to try to spend too little than too much, but spending too much is just as bad, if not worse, right? If you're going to renovate, especially like in rental properties, right? You have to renovate a property to the standards of the neighborhood, right? If you're in like a low-income Section 8 neighborhood, you don't want your house being the friggin' Taj Mahal. You want it being one of the nicer ones that the tenant base has, but like, you don't need to do a $40,000 kitchen renovation in a $90,000 house. You know what I'm saying? Likewise, though, and this is where more of you are guilty, trying to cheap out on the renovation, right? Say so the contractor gives you a bid for like $30K, and you're like, oh, how can I got like $6K. What can we do for that? You got to provide your tenants or your would-be buyers with a solid product, okay? You cannot skip out, right? If somebody, a professional, tells you it's going to cost X to do the job, and you're like, well, how do we do the same job but for like a third of the cost? Bro, it doesn't work that way. You get what you pay for, okay? So, guys, make sure that you're doing quality rehab. Anytime you try to take the cheap route, it almost always ends up costing you more in the long run, because you're going to probably try to do the cheap route instead of hiring like a legitimate contractor. Maybe you hire some dude off of Craigslist because he was cheaper than everybody else. Why was he cheaper than everybody else, folks? Think about that. If the market dictates the prices here, and like you talk to five contractors and they're all about right here, and then some other schmo that you've never heard of is down here, there's a reason he's down here, guys. And you end up going to pay him that money, and then you're going to go back and you're going to pay the good contractor the same price they wanted, plus the money it takes to fix that guy, plus fix that guy's crappy work, plus the money you're out for already paying that guy, right? So don't spend too little on that rehab, okay? Here's a good one. Selling too quickly. And this is a nice one. This happens to long-term buy and hold investors. This happens. Y'all get too scared, man. I see this all the time, dude. At the beginning, right, when I was talking about like duplexes and stuff, right? Like we're in the cash flow markets, right? Your low-income markets, right? Cleveland, right? Ohio, right? Detroit, Indianapolis. Think about these kind of places. Memphis, right? Places where stuff is super cheap, rents are super high, right? So when I got started in this business, right, you know, lots of duplexes, dude. You get them for like freaking $30K, rent for like $1,200 a month. And I've seen this with a lot of investors, right? They get these duplexes, and then, you know, you're in the low-income space, you're going to get bad tenants. Bad tenants are going to trash your units. We'll see things like, oh, you get one of those duplexes, and then you get a run of a little bit of bad luck, and the tenant jacks up your property, or you got to evict the tenant, and you got to shell out $4,000 or $5,000, and then you're looking at your numbers, and maybe you've owned your houses for 18 months, and you're like, I didn't cash flow. I actually was in the negative because I had to do this turnover, this eviction, and put a new roof on the property all in these 18 months. This must be a loser investment. And then you sell the property, and then you lose money, of course, on the cost of the sale, because you got your like 7, 6, 7, 8, 9% commissions. You got your closing costs, right? The whole thing all usually tallies up to almost 10%, right? So you get people that run in to a little bit of bad luck that's completely normal in this business and should be underwritten into all your deals, especially low-income deals, and they panic sell, okay? Well, those same people are freaking really hurting right now because those $30,000 duplexes that I'm talking about are worth like $150, $160, $170, and those $1,200 rents are like $1,800, $1,900 a day. You don't think they wish they could have that back? You don't think they wish they wouldn't have panic sold? Again, I told you, real estate is imperfect. A lot of us make a lot of our money because other people make mistakes. I'm trying to teach you guys how not to be those people. All the people that bought those duplexes when those investors got scared and they had the fortitude to hold on to them, they're like me. They're sitting pretty on a pile of friggin' money, right? So don't sell too quickly. Don't hit the panic button the moment a little bit of adversity hits you, guys. If you buy the property right, it will generally always go up in value. The rent will generally always go up. Even if you run into a couple years where you're not cash flowing what you want to be, do not necessarily hit the abort button. It's probably going to cost you more money, right? If you hold steady, you'll probably make more money, right? Speaking of that, number six, being undercapitalized. This is a big one. This might cause you to have to sell too quickly, even if you don't want to, right? I've seen people do this, and this is crazy to me that people will do this. They will spend their last penny on like a rental property, okay? And then they need that rental property income to be able to pay for that rental property mortgage, maybe sometimes even pay for their own mortgage. And then the moment they run into a problem, like their low-income tenant stops paying rent, they can't pay their own mortgage or the mortgage on that rental. Folks, you can't do that. You cannot set your life and your business up where you are literally relying on your tenant paying their bills to pay your own bills. You need to have reserves. You need to be able to weather these storms, right? Or else you're going to have to sell too quickly. You're missing out on huge opportunities. Or what's even worse, I've seen several investors. I'm actually working with one right now that you get to the point where the tenant ain't paying rent. You can't pay the mortgage, and now you're getting foreclosed on. I got this one guy. I'm literally working with him right now. He's got a property. The tenant stopped paying rent, okay? And this guy stopped paying his bills because he can't pay the mortgage, right? So now he's facing foreclosure on this rental property. And he didn't even have enough money to pay the property management team like $750 to evict the tenant, right? So now he's trying to sell the property before the bank forecloses on him. And let me tell you, to get somebody to buy that property where you have like a tenant who's been living there for quite a while without paying rent, they ain't gonna pay nearly as much as they would if that property was vacant and they didn't have to inherit that bad problem, right? So by not having like $750 to follow through on an eviction, this guy is literally gonna lose tens of thousands of dollars worth of equity, right? So don't get into this being undercapitalized, guys. You have to have money to weather storms. You can't rely on these tenants. If a tenant misses a bill and that causes your life to jackknife, you are too undercapitalized. Do not do that, okay? Number seven, mistake, not understanding the law. I see this because I deal with a lot of out-of-state investors, right? The laws in Detroit, they ain't the same as in California. The laws in Ohio, they ain't the same as they are in Portland. The laws in Memphis, they are not the same as they are in New Jersey. We see a lot of out-of-state investors coming to these cash flow markets, and they don't understand the landlord-tenant laws. They don't know if there is or is not rent control. They don't know the process of notifying tenants of lease changes, rent increases, things of that nature. They don't know how the eviction process works. They don't know what can be done if a tenant stops paying rent. They don't know the types of requirements that these cities and building inspectors have, whether it be annual rental inspections, lead paint inspections, point of sale inspections when they go to sell. They don't know any of this stuff, and they're totally lost, and they find themselves getting fined or screwed with by the city. You got to understand the law. It goes back to the first ones of not acting fast enough and acting too fast, right? You don't want to sit on the sidelines forever, but you got to do a little bit of research before you invest this money, guys. You got to at least, if you've chosen a market, you got to figure out what the laws are, man. You can't be a landlord if you don't know the landlord-tenant laws of the municipality that your property is in, right? So don't do that. In addition to understanding the laws, brings me to number eight, you got to understand the tenant base, okay? Let me tell you this. I know you get a bunch of weirdos out there that say things like, we're all people, we're all the same. We ain't the same, bro. Okay, people are very different, right? We're not even necessarily so much in the building business as we are in the people business when we're investing in real estate. Let me tell you this. If I am buying like beachfront rental properties in Miami, my tenant base is going to have a lot of different life experiences and expectations and behavior traits than if I am buying Section 8 housing in Memphis, okay? Two totally different ball games, two totally different levels of service, two totally different ways that I, as a landlord, need to go about my business. You cannot treat someone living in like an A-grade ultra-luxury rental the same way you treat a Section 8 tenant living in, you know, a high-crime, high-poverty area, and don't expect them to treat you the same. These are like two types of people that are going to be completely different, and you need to operate your business with an understanding of the type of tenant base you are dealing with. I see people who do not understand that. That is like trying to fit a round peg in a square hole. Do not do that, right? Now, number nine, one of my favorites, being afraid to evict tenants. I don't know what it is with newbie investors, but I've made so much money buying properties for like steep, stupid discounts because there's some asshat tenant in there who ain't paying rent and the landlord's like too afraid to evict them. I don't know what it is, guys, but evictions aren't that scary, okay? I've got freaking hundreds and hundreds of eviction videos on Holton Wise TV. Take a look, right? Sometimes they're rough, but you hire a property manager, let's take care of it for you. You cannot be in this game if you are afraid to evict people. That's like going to war, not being willing to shoot your friggin' rifle. That is your ultimate trump card, okay? Eviction, right? Tenants do not, like, do what you say just because you say it, okay? They do it because you have the ability to make them homeless, right? That is your ultimate card. Like, if they don't do what you tell them to do, you remove their housing. If they know you're not going to remove the housing, what can you do? Nothing, really. That is, like, literally what you need to do. So those landlords that are scared to do evictions, guys, you got to nut up here, right? You got to be ready, willing, and able to evict people. Who cares? Don't listen to them cry like, oh, you made them homeless. You didn't make them homeless. They were stealing from you, stopped them from stealing from you. And then you get the other landlords that don't have a problem like with wanting their tenants out of their houses, but they're like afraid of the court system. First of all, the legal costs, yeah, nobody likes paying legal costs. I don't like lawyers. I think lawyers and dentists are too, like, you know, I don't know. I think I might actually hate lawyers and dentists, specifically lawyers, more than I hate tenants who don't pay me rent. Nobody really likes dealing with them, but you know, it's a necessary evil. And they're expensive. Yeah, that's why you hate them usually, but they're not as expensive as not solving the problem or panic selling because you don't want to pay it. Sometimes you just got to bite the bullet, make sure you're capitalized enough, and pay the cost. What's even worse than that is the people who are just like, no, I don't want to pay the costs. Let's offer the tenant cash for keys. Oh, God, don't do that, dude. Way back in the day when I first got started, maybe I thought about it or did it like once or twice or at least offered it. Didn't ever really work out. And then, you know, I got smart and I realized, what the fuck am I doing? This is a total amateur hour. You do not negotiate with terrorists, folks. You cannot reward their horrible behavior. And plus, they'll see that you're soft. And if you give these kinds of people an inch, they will take a mile and they'll keep taking and they'll keep taking and they'll keep taking. And if you're one of those investors too that's thinking about like growing a large business, scaling a large business, you cannot let that type of information get out there in the public, right? Say you have like 50 rentals in one particular neighborhood and then word around the neighborhood gets like, you know, thrown around that, hey, Jimmy over there, go live in his house. And then if you stop paying him rent, he won't even evict you. He'll give you even more money. So you get to live. People are like, wait, I get to live in this dude's house for free for X amount of months, and then he gives me more money? Hell yeah, right? You can't do that. You got to evict him, folks. You cannot be afraid of evictions. Do not become an investor. Do not buy a property until you've got your head around the fact that evictions are good for you. That is a good tool and weapon that you as a landlord have. And then last but not least, probably my favorite, and I see this all the time with new investors, getting caught up in tenant drama, okay? For whatever reason, new investors don't seem to understand the separation between tenant landlord, right? They don't understand the appropriate level of involvement you as a landlord need to get into these people's lives. The tenants, especially your low-income tenants, these folks are just, they live chaotic, drama-filled lives, okay? Things are always going wild, right? These are the kind of people that they're breaking up with their boyfriend. They're getting back together with their boyfriend. They're doing this. They're doing that. They got a baby daddy over here, a baby daddy over there. They're changing their jobs every 6 months, right? And we're not even talking about, like, getting better jobs. We're talking, like, lateral movements because they're, like, emotional, right? They get very, very emotional, and then they make rash decisions based upon that emotion, right? Well, they will try to pull you as the landlord into that, like, emotional roller coaster and chaos in regards to, like, everything. Like, oh, I don't have rent this month because, and then start explaining all these things to you, right? Or, like, you know, they're arguing with a neighbor or this or that, and they'll just try to explain it, or they're telling you about their kid being sick or this or that. Just anything, right? They're trying to constantly, like, just pull you into this chaotic drama. Dude, you are their landlord. You are a real estate investor. You are not their friend. You are not their doctor. You are not their social worker. You are not their psychiatrist. You are not their bartender. You are not there to listen to the problems they have. Your job is to tell them when rent is due, collect rent on the due date, and make sure their house is habitable and up to current rental standards. No more. No less. What's going on in their lives? Irrelevant. Enforce your rental contract. Nothing more, nothing less. Communicate with them only when absolutely necessary. You could be polite, but you don't need to get up involved in their lives. Do not get sucked into their drama. Do not become friends with them. Do not hang out with them. Do not go to little Johnny's 5-year-old birthday, okay? Don't invite them to your house for a barbecue, folks. Arm's length, do not get caught up in the drama. That's honestly probably the biggest one. For whatever reason, new investors, and it, like, the biggest thing too is just, like, accepting excuses for, like, why rent isn't paid on time and then not doing the eviction because, oh, well, yeah, I didn't file the eviction against her because, you know, she had this go wrong, and she said that she was going to make up for it in 2 months, blah, 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 blah. If an investor that does that is still in the game 5 years later, I guarantee you they ain't doing that again. You get a lot of seasoned investors, seasoned landlords to be like, oh, yeah, I remember when I took excuses or got caught up in their drama back in the beginning. I cut that shit out, right? Nobody makes it in this game if they're getting caught up in the tenant drama. Those are probably the 10 things that y'all do when you get started. The most common, you know, those are the most common mistakes y'all make, right? And a lot of times it costs y'all money. And then people like me, we make money off of that. So if you want to be on the right side of the money-making equation, I suggest you do not do any of those 10 things. And if you are like a seasoned landlord or a seasoned investor and you're watching this, let me know some other things you see people doing that I missed. I'd like to hear about that. Maybe you're a real estate agent watching this. What do you see your clients doing? Maybe you're a brand new investor yourself and you're currently making some of these mistakes. Let's talk about it, man. Let's chop it up in the comments right now.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to Holton Wise TV for more financial information, education, and entertainment.